in this edition of Art Loft, the Curator's Collection, the projects in Fat Village, featuring author Michael Largo.
There's so many things we appreciate their beauty, but we don't know a lot of things about them. We see their pink color, but that comes from their diet of shrimp and brine and...
Christy Gast at Locos Projects.
This is the largest textile sculpture that I've ever made. And I grew up in the country, and there was very little access to the arts when I was a kid, but I learned how to sew. That's what the women in my family did for a living.
Phillida Barlow.
Those materials that begin as a powder, then you add a liquid to them and they become a very different kind of materials. They seem to have a lifespan of their own, and I'm curious about working with that process.
Vanitas at Bass Museum of Art.
The butterfly, which is seen as something that is, you know, fragile, beautiful, but quick to die, incorporated in a way that doesn't focus on those darker themes, yet holds them.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft's The Curator's Collection.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from the projects in Fat Village in Fort Lauderdale, this is Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Art Loft's The Curator's Collection is a series of monthly specials inviting leading South Florida galleries, museums, and local arts innovators to curate episodes based on their artistic vision. Together, we discuss their favorite Art Loft profiles and look at how the artists and performers featured are impacting the arts community. For this episode, we welcome guest curator Leah Brown, the exhibitions director of the projects in Fat Village. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thanks so much for having me.
So tell us a little bit about yourself and also about Fat Village.
I am a studio artist and a curator. I've been living in Fort Lauderdale, Florida for the past 8 years or so. And I've always been really passionate about art in all of its capacities. I got into curating because I saw so many wonderful artists that were creating around me, and I started making connections. So in conjunction with my husband, Peter Simmons, we curate the project space here in Fat Village.
Which is such a great place. It has so many, it's grown so much since one of the first times I was here, and it also has such a variety of great artists.
That's true, yeah. Fat Village has really come into its own in the last several years. We've seen our crowds swell during our monthly art walks, which is the last Saturday of every month, swell from a few hundred people to now a couple of thousand people on each art walk. And we really see Fat Village as being a place where artists and the public can come together. You know, we create work that is outside of the realm of commercial galleries. So we are trying to give people an experience when they come here. And we're also trying to give possibilities to artists to create large scale works and to curators to express their visions in the spaces as well.
Thanks so much, Leah. Our first selection originally aired in Art Loft's second season. We met with author Michael Largo to discuss his fanciful title, The Big Bad Book of Beasts, The World's Most Curious Creatures. Leah, why did this particular title stand out to you?
In my own studio practice, I'm very interested in the way that people create mythologies and histories in a way that brings magic back into our lives. And this was a way that Michael is literally referencing the way that history is perceived as magical and how things can be both real and unreal at the same time.
So. He definitely forces us to look at nature in a really different way.
It's true. You know, when we actually consider the animals that surround us, these are consciousnesses that are very alien, and yet at the same time, they absolutely exist. The way that they perceive is so different than ours, and I think that's interesting.
I do too. So now we have author Michael Largo.
I'm a writer, and I'm here discussing my latest book, The Big Bad Book of Beasts, which is a compendium of animals, both real, mystical, and extinct. I got the inspiration from medieval books. They were called bestiaries. These are one of the first bestsellers. They were only second in popularity to the Bible. And what they contained was a list of animals, both real and imagined, and they were gorgeously illustrated, hand done by monks. And when I got a hold of these books, it just was amazing to see the variety of animals that they had and what they thought about it. So I started to, you know, just get fun with the idea of, you know, is there even a mean-spirited termite or a butterfly who's frightened of flying? You know, even among the flamingos that are behind us, which is, you know, a wonderful species, there's so many things we appreciate their beauty, but we don't know a lot of things about them. We see their pink color, but that comes from their diet of shrimp and brine, and you can tell if they're having a sufficient amount of the particular shrimp that they like by their pinkness. The other thing that you'll notice about them is that they always seem to be preening themselves. So they've had a reputation in folklore of being, you know, pretty birds. And what they're actually doing with that preening is there's a gland right near their tail that contains an oil that allows their feathers to stay waterproof. So if they don't preen themselves for 3 or 4 hours a day, it's not for cosmetics as much as it's for survival. It's long legs, they fold forward as opposed to our knees. Its beak is this scoop-shaped beak, but what it does is it uses it almost kind of like as a gold miner's pen, scooping up the, looking for the different crabs or the brine or the shrimp in the soil. And they're sleeping, but half of their brain sleeps at a time, one half, the other half. So they're always sort of alert in their environment. It's those type of small facts that I tried to include in this new book that would make people look at nature and animals and the world we live in a new way, and hopefully that would lead to a more humane treatment of animals in general. There's another interesting bird that the medieval society really believed exists, and I actually have wood carvings of this, which I included in the books. And it was a bird called a Caldarius, and I subtitled Dr. Bird. This all white bird had remarkable powers to detect human sickness and death, according to Roman legend. Supposedly, the Caldarius was used by ancient Romans to determine the seriousness of illness. If the bird turned its back on someone sick, all further treatment would be halted because the patient was destined to die. There apparently were cases when the Caldarius hopped on the chest of the infirm until reaching the face. It then plucked a hair from the eyebrows or head, immediately took flight through an open window and made a beeline straight to the clouds. It was thought that if the bird took the sickness into the heavens, it had burned and had it burned off by the sun. The Caldarius thus was the last hope of the terminally ill. We still don't understand all the mysteries that animals possess and the ways that they communicate and their sense of interpreting the world that is still a mystery and an amazing quality that they have to teach us.
You're watching Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Up next, we revisit Christy Gast's exhibition In Holdings. At Locust Projects in Miami, Gast explores the contrasts between two very unlikely neighbors, tropical wetlands and a disarmed missile. What was your takeaway from this profile, Leah?
Well, Christy is a very interesting sculptor. She's really confronting objects and instances in the natural world that hold a kind of natural mystery about them and reimagining them as a scene that happens in her own sort of personal mythology.
I'm sensing a theme here. You talk a lot about your interest in mythology and nature. How'd this come about?
I am very interested in how people create their own mythologies. For me, that comes in linking what happens between dreams, in my own dreams. But people are doing it in different ways across the artistic fields. So that's really what I wanted to explore with these segments.
Up next, Christy Gast at Locust Projects.
Christy Gass is a Miami-based artist, and she's taken this opportunity and worked over a year on this project that's really inspired by a disarmed nuclear missile in Everglades National Park. So part of what we do as an organization is give artists the chance to make it a real site-specific exhibition. So she's really engaged with Everglades National Park for this show, something that already exists there, but really making it her own.
The first piece that the audience encounters when they walk through the door is a video entitled War Drums that was shot in one take at dawn in one of the last stands of Slash Pine Forest, which was the native forest that originally covered a lot of Dade County. I wrote a score for two performers, two drummers, two percussionists, a conga player and a snare player. And I shot sort of one long circular take through the forest that passed by each of them individually. For this show, I was looking at the Hole in the Donut region of the Everglades, which was sort of full of these pine forests until the early 20th century when they were raised for tomato fields. They went fallow and were overgrown by Brazilian pepper. And around the same time, the military built a base there during the Cold War, and it was on high alert during the Cuban Missile Crisis. It was one of the Nike missile bases in South Florida. So I thought that just the story of conflict as witnessed by this one particular place was really interesting, and I wanted to explore that in an artwork.
So she's incorporated this handmade textile that is camouflaged with the various plants in the Everglades, plants that have changed over time because of the use of the land there. And it will overtake the gallery space in this huge sculpture that will hang from the ceiling, and viewers can come in and walk in and around and under it.
This is the largest textile sculpture that I've ever made. And I grew up in the country, and there was very little access to the arts when I was a kid, but I learned how to sew. That's what the women in my family did for a living. So it's always been a medium that I've been interested in and just kind of skilled at. And so it's always something that I go back to when I'm thinking through a project.
This edition of Art Loft's The Curator's Collection is being curated by the exhibitions director of the projects in Fat Village, Leah Brown. Leah, this next artist's work is so big. I love her scale and her mixture of different objects, really objects that sort of oppose one another. What spoke to you?
Oh, I like the sense of scale and the materiality as well. I also like how she's using the monumentality of the work to create a real sense of place. When you see her work, it's as though you're going through a landscape that both exists and yet it doesn't exist, in the sense that these are poetic objects. These are objects that are recreating history in a way that only she can see and we as viewers just get a hint of.
Now we have Phyllida Barlow.
I'm Phyllida Barlow. I'm an artist. I make sculpture, large installations and smaller works and drawings. The columns are made from a polystyrene core that's coated with scrim and cement and ribbons, all bound together in the cement. They go 6 meters high, which is about 20 foot, 18 foot, something like that. Some works, there is a clarity about what they are, and other works, there is no clarity, and I work across the two different ways of working, but nearly all the work is subjected to quite a lot of change in the process of making, even if I have a clear idea. I knew for the column work that I wanted columns, but I wasn't entirely sure how they would finally end up. They began as very clear cylindrical objects stacked on top of each other, and then I thought they looked, for me, very bland, so I began to work into the polystyrene, allowing it to be randomly eaten away by cutting into it, which I did with a team of assistants. And then I'm fascinated by materials that go through a natural process of change, like plaster cement. Those materials that begin as a powder, then you add a liquid to them and they become a very different kind of materials. They seem to have a lifespan of their own, and I'm curious about working with that process. So these are working with cement as a very modeled surface over the core of polystyrene. And I had the idea of, I like the idea of materials colliding with each other or clashing, and ribbons and cement seem a very opposing kind of combination. And so the column is a kind of cliche of monumentalism, but I was quite interested in trying to somehow undermine that. And so the ruined look of them and them being kind of bound in ribbons which are half submerged by the cement surface, for me is a kind of comment on maybe things that have outlived their moment of grandeur and become something else. It's based on an upturned house. I mean, I think whatever the starting point is for me, I always want the work to travel some way away from that. I'm not particularly interested in thinking of an image and then making that. I'm interested in triggers to a process of making, and then that takes over and becomes the work. But the upturned houses, this is the third out of three, and they had a very, very specific starting point. Listening to a program on the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, and the journalist reporter was interviewing various people who've been through the experience and all the tragic circumstances that surrounded Katrina. But one account in particular really struck me because it was so solitary and so heroic in its own kind of unsung way. It was a man who went to find his house after the great assault of the flooding river. And he'd been in this sports center and then set out to find his house. And he knew where to go exactly. But the further he went towards where the streets were where he lived, the more flattened they were and absolutely drenched in this thick silt. And then he saw his house. But he didn't mention the word house. He mentioned the word home. He said, "I saw my home." And he approached it and he realized the whole structure had been turned completely upside down and his home was resting on its roof. But it was the description he gave of encountering this familiar thing in a completely unusual way, in a devastating way. But to me, the poetry of his description was exactly like somebody would describe sculpture, where you can't name the object that you're looking at, but your way of encountering it or walking around it creates an entirely new description of the experience that you're having. And I thought it was just incredibly moving. And it was a trigger to thinking of upturned objects and the way you might flip something over and it becomes a completely different thing. And so that was the source of these three upturned houses. And this is the third of those three. and it's a broken upturned house. The surprise of it is obviously something that I definitely caught, you know, I enjoy that way of working, especially with sculpture, which is so physically static, you know, to be involved in something which refuses to have a finite starting point or end point is to me quite important.
Welcome back, art lovers. This is Art Loft's The Curator's Collection, the projects in Fat Village. In this next selection, we were welcomed by the Bass Museum of Art in Miami Beach. There, we toured the exhibition Vanitas, Fashion and Art. Now, this is another piece that incorporates very different pairings, especially since, for me, fashion is one of my, like, best worldly pleasures.
Yeah, I like fashion too. With this exhibit, what I found so compelling about the individual artworks, because I do see them as artworks, not just fashion or costumes, but through that costuming, what we have is a character that's created. And because the fanciful nature of these costumes is so reminiscent of fairy tales or magical people and places.
Like the butterfly dress.
Like the butterfly dress, yeah, and like the bone dress as well. What happens is the viewers have a sense of a character, although that character isn't yet present.
Let's check out Fashion and Art.
Harold Coda, curator in charge of the Costume Institute at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and I'm a consulting curator here at the Bass Museum. The Bass Museum is hosting an exhibition called Vanitas, Fashion and Art, which is one of the first, I believe, exhibitions here that focuses on actual apparel. Vanitas, the title of the exhibition, is really derived from 17th century Dutch still lives. Vanitas, vanitatum, omnia vanitas was an exhortation in the Bible about the ephemerality of life and worldly pursuit. So it's vanity, vanity, all is vanity. Physical beauty at its peak, but poised on the point of its slipping into rot. One of the first things that the public will see is an Iris van Herpen dress that it alludes to vanitas themes without actually being about vanitas. The designer skydives, and she says when she's in free fall, she feels such a sense of liberation and freedom that she wanted somehow to encapsulate that in a garment. And so what she's done is perhaps counterintuitive. She's created a skeleton to put over the body as a way to suggest the liberation of the spirit. It's about freedom. It's a spectacular Sarah Burton dress. You see a mannequin that is floating up off the ground wearing one of her butterfly dresses. And it's as if a swarm of butterflies has created an armor over this woman. So there you see the butterfly, which is seen as something that is, you know, fragile, beautiful, but quick to die, incorporated in a way that doesn't focus on those darker themes, yet holds them and is presented in a way that is aestheticizing. You know, what I love about Miami and Miami Beach is that it's this intersections of so many cultures, but it's especially the Latino culture that infuses this whole environment. And I think that a Vanitas exhibition as a spring show, you know, spring, rejuvenation, happiness. It's not really logical for most places. But within Spanish culture, there's this thing where you can decorate death. And so it seems like to have a spring show of Vanitas is not inappropriate in a culture which isn't afraid of addressing death as an issue, mortality as an issue. That it's something that has to do with resurrection, rejuvenation, as much as it has to do with loss. And Vanitas is not a logical subject for fashion. Fashion is about optimism, looking to the future, capturing desire and seduction, luxury. You can look at the fine art pieces and say, you know, even these themes can percolate into the field that's seen as superficial as fashion, that even these richer narratives can also abide in something like a spring dress.
Thanks so much for joining us this week. And a special thanks goes to our guest curator, the exhibitions director of the projects in Fat Village, Leah Brown. Leah, thanks for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
It was a lot of fun. For more information about the projects in Fat Village, visit fatvillage.com. I'm Kaylin James, reminding you to stay creative. See you next time on Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Bye. Calling South Florida arts innovators. The Night Arts Challenge Miami is accepting submissions. The submissions window opens on April 4th. Have an idea for an innovative South Florida-based arts project? Well, there are several community conversation events where you can learn more. For complete listings and details, visit knightfoundation.org.
That's all I do. I don't say anything.
I think I'll.
Thank you. Let's roll in. We need a guard.
Oh, no.
I hate when I say wonderful. Ugh.
Wonderful.
Did great.
Okay, I didn't do anything. Was I supposed to do something at that point?
No.
Okay.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.